knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Picking up where we left off in the previous tutorial, there are now Homo sapiens all over the planet, from Africa to Europe, Asia, Australia, as well as North and South America. What were the lives of these people like? For a long time, there were two hypotheses, seemingly opposing one another. One argued that the Ice Age world was comprised of small, egalitarian bands. These people would have lived in societies where all members were roughly equal in status. Endemic violence and hierarchy were results of settled life, and competition for resources grew more fierce. The other idea was one of constant violence, that people lived in a band dominated by a chief, who commonly warred with other chiefs. It was proposed that with the invention of settled life and civilization, that endemic violence diminished. However, both hypotheses drew these conclusions from a perceived lack of complexity in the hunter-gatherer world. What is complexity? It's a term used more and more in anthropology, yet it is incredibly difficult to define. It's a very loaded term, and entire books exist trying to define it. Complexity in archaeology refers to the degree or scale of an aspect of culture a group utilizes. A fairly straightforward example would be the complexity of road building. A culture that builds paved stone roads would be more complex than one using dirt trails in this regard. Building the stone-paved roads is much more involved. More people are needed to plan these roads. More people need to mine the stone for the roads. More people are needed to build them. So a more complex system is needed to oversee their creation and upkeep. It should be understood that if it is said that a society is less complex than another, this isn't saying it is inferior in any way. Billions of people around the world find more comfort and happiness in a simple life rather than an overly complex one. People of a small farming town are equally as important as people living in metropolitan cities. We have attempted to reconstruct the lives of these ancient hunter-gatherers in two ways, through ethnographic research of modern or historic hunter-gatherers, and through archaeology. For a while, ethnographic research seemed to corroborate early views on low hunter-gatherer complexity. However, diving deeper into the research, the view becomes cloudier. An important realization was that we can't use the current or historic records of hunter-gatherers to view ancient ones, for several reasons. Today, and in the recent past, hunter-gatherers in most places have been relegated to undesirable, comparatively unproductive land by settled societies. We can't use a tribe living in the desert to approximate a tribe occupying the Fertile Crescent of the Middle East. Their environments lend completely different complexities and lifestyles. The other factor is that early ethnographers didn't fully realize how epidemics and social collapse worked. For example, a lack of complexity among Amazonian hunter-gatherers was more likely a result of years of epidemics and colonization rather than the fact that they were hunter-gatherers. Despite this, some ethnographic research countered these studies. During the late 19th century, anthropologists were recording the lives of hunter-gatherer people of the Pacific Northwest coast of the United States. They showed a high degree of complexity, living in permanent communities of several hundred, with hundreds of these towns throughout coastal valleys in the region, and a high population density. Their towns had monumental architecture and complex political structures, showing clear signs of hierarchical rule. Warfare occurred as it did in any society. In fact, we have archaeological evidence of indigenous fortresses in the region. But warfare wasn't constant, and peace was common. The political and social landscape was highly complex, changing as new rulers rose to power, alliances formed and broke, and trade flowed between groups. Yet they practiced no large-scale agriculture. This complexity was achieved due to the high productivity of the Pacific waters, supplementing hunting and gathering. Even with other examples, these societies were seen as exceptions rather than the rule. Archaeology provides another lens with which to view complexity in ancient hunter-gatherers. In 1942, a burial was found at the Italian site of Arene Candide called Il Principe, or the Young Prince. This burial is of a high-status young member of an Ice Age hunter-gatherer society. Dating to 24,000 years ago, the body was laid on a bed of ochre. Hundreds of pieces of jewelry made from mammoth ivory, teeth, and claws adorn the body. Beads of carved shells make up his headdress, and several bone-carved tools were placed around his body. A large 15-centimeter lithic blade was held in his hand. Who knows what kind of wood and textiles the burial also contained? The body was then covered in a layer of yellow ochre and buried. This is strong evidence of social and political complexity. The young man likely held some inherited status in his society, challenging the notion of strictly egalitarian bands existing during this time period. A site from archaic North America, known as Poverty Point, is another site occupied by hunter-gatherers. Incredibly, this site features a large pyramidal mound at its center, surrounded by settlements and other mounds. Up to 1,000 people may have lived here. At 22 meters high and 200 by 200 meters across, this monumental work must have been a huge undertaking for the people of Poverty Point. Yet no signs of intensive agriculture have appeared at the site. In both of these cases, prehistoric Europe and North America, people had large trade networks connecting thousands of miles, as is evident in the archaeological record through techniques like lithic sourcing. With all this new evidence, it was clear that those early presumptions were off base. Even so, a great deal of data does suggest the presence of less complex hunter-gatherer groups, as well as egalitarian societies. These give us fascinating looks into a style of life unfamiliar to us. Therefore, the current view is recognizing that hunter-gatherers aren't monolithic. No single lifestyle, degree of complexity, or subsistence strategy exemplifies all hunter-gatherers. The reality seems to be that the Ice Age was an incredibly complex world, with different groups utilizing different strategies. Groups with social stratification interacted with egalitarian people. Some societies may have occupied year-round fishing settlements, while others lived nomadically, hunting megafauna. These people were then connected through wide-ranging trade networks. Political entities rose and fell, and it's likely that countless incredible historical events occurred, now lost to time. This isn't even mentioning the non-Homo sapiens landscape of the Ice Age. During this period, other human species existed throughout the Old World, Neanderthals, Denisovans, and others that we covered earlier in the series. We can only imagine the different interactions all these different groups had. Megafauna was also present all around the world, from giant woolly mammoths and saber-toothed cats to the giant ground sloths of the Americas. Imagining all of this, the Ice Age seems more like a world out of a fantasy story than the Earth today, but it was very real. During this period, humanity also became friends with another species, wolves. Thousands of years of selective breeding has turned these furry friends into the dogs we are familiar with today. Some Homo sapiens living more sedentary lives began building bigger and bigger settlements with monumental architecture. By at least 6,000 years ago, we see the rise of cities, highly complex settlements with tens of thousands of people. How did this transition occur? Why? To answer this, let's discuss the rise of civilizations.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.